there.
Oh yeah, there as well. Oh, then, oh yeah.
Oh no, no, no.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Blitz! I called it blitz.
What was that?
Oh, Jack! Oh my gosh! Get down.
Alice, don't leave your pop!
I really need a break. Good morning. Welcome to Martinsburg Grace Brethren Church. It's great to worship with you this morning. If you're visiting with us for the very first time, we would encourage you to fill out one of these cards in the pew rack in front of you and drop it in the offering plate. It just gives the staff an opportunity to get to know a little bit more about you and who you are. If you have a child during the service today that becomes discontented, please feel free to take them to the family room located near the information desk. Ladies Encounter has an upcoming event, and here's a video clip.
Ladies Encounter invites all ladies and teen girls to attend our fall encounter on Tuesday, October the 18th at the Northern Bedford County High School in Lloydsburg, beginning at 7 p.m. Christian actress Anita Gutchick will dramatize the lives of three biblical women, Esther, Lot's wife, and Rahab. Each of these women had major decisions to make.
Mordecai would not bow before Haman. Mordecai would only bow before his God.
Join us as Anita shares their stories, reaching across the generations to touch our hearts and encourage us to make wise decisions as we face the challenges of our daily lives. There will be no admission charge, but a free will offering will be received. We look forward to seeing you on October the 18th at the Northern Bedford County High School.
We have youth calendars for the month of October available at our information desk. So if you have a student in the youth group, please pick one up so you can know what's happening this month. October 13th, this coming Thursday, we will be having another Theology Thursday. We will be covering the topic of hell, why is hell necessary, and how does hell show us the goodness of God. Today, we have cell groups from 4 to 6. We have our junior high cell group. It will be over at Phil and Becky Culp's. And from 6 to 8, we will have our senior high cell group, and that will be at Brad and Heidi Stearns. On Saturday, October 29th, we will be having our barn bash for our Synergy Youth Group. All students from 6th to 12th grade are welcome to come out to the Culp Farm. It'll be a great time. I hope to see you there.
Thank you for worshiping with us today. For more information on church activities, please see your bulletin or go to our website at mgbconline.com.
Good morning. It's good to see you all here with us this morning. If you would stand up as we do our call to worship. Psalm 111, 10. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding. His praise endures forever. Let's pray. Lord, thank you so very much for the opportunity to be able to be here this morning and to learn more about you. I pray that your Holy Spirit would change us, challenge us, that we would be more like you. Thank you so much for your love for us, and I pray that we would be willing to be receivers of that and then distributors as well as we interact with others throughout this week. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me, and I once was lost, but now I was blind, but now I see. thousand years, bright shining as the sun. We've known less days to sing God's praise than when we first began.
Thank you. Boom. All right. Enough of that. Hey, what the? Hey! Hey! Anybody in there? Pastor Bob? You in there? I don't see.
Hey, Carl!
Huh?
Carl, what are you doing here?
Oh, hey!
Hi, Carl!
Howdy. I come up here for the treats on the street, and if you can't get in, I don't know what's going on.
Well, you're right. You usually do come here to get your candy on trick-or-treat night, but this year we're trying something different.
Oh!
This year, instead of having a big event here at church, all of our people went to their own homes in the community, and they're having trick-or-treat sites at their house.
Oh, all right. So I can get some candy there?
You sure can.
Yeah.
Okay.
Here's a map that you can find the different locations. They have a blue light out on the front.
Okay. Look for the blue light.
That's right.
The blue light.
Okay.
Would you like some candy and maybe a hot dog before you leave? Or you know what? I have a Bible. Do you have a Bible at home?
I have one, but not like that.
Oh,
I'll
great.
Take that.
Would you like some candy too before you leave?
Well,
I see you have a pumpkin there.
I do, but I'm kind of allergic to candy and sugar, really, in general. But I do like trick-or-treating.
Okay.
So, you got any deep-fried Pop-Tarts in there?
Don't have any Pop-Tarts, sorry.
Well, all right, where do I start?
Well, the first site that you can go to is right across the parking lot at Ryan's house. Do you know Ryan from church?
What? Do I know Ryan? Who do you think I'm dressed as?
Well,
Ryan Ritchie, the one-man praise band.
That's a really good costume,
Thank
Carl.
You. Thank
you. Know what?
You.
I bet nobody would have guessed that.
Well, they might not. You're right.
Well, Carl, we're really glad that you came tonight. We're glad that you came and thought of us.
All right. Well, I'm going to go over there to Ryan's. I'll see you guys. Oh, that candy's probably going to go straight to my hips. That candy goes straight to my hips. Oh, yeah. Oh, that candy's probably going to go straight to my hips. That candy straight to my hips. Oh, candy's probably going to go straight to my hips. That candy straight to my hips. Oh, yeah.
Guess I can go back and sit down for a while. Danny just keeps, Carl keeps going on and on and on. Hey, I've got something exciting, a recommendation from the pastor, a new book to read, The Church Directory, okay? They're in. If you ordered one, you can pick one up today, located outside the church offices. So you go right outside the back door into the office wing, and there's tables set up there. There'll be folks there to get your copy. So if you ordered one, you can pick one up. There's incredible reading, interesting facts, tidbits, information, exciting pictures, lots of pictures. And I know that, I have to admit, I went through here, there were some people in here that I didn't know. I'm sorry. I'm working on that. So we are going to be having a test among the pastoral staff on Tuesday. They're going to have to go through, and we're going to be quizzing them on different people, their pictures, and who they are. So if you did not order one and would like one, I believe there's a couple more copies available for you to purchase. Again, at the table outside of the church offices there, you can pick it up after this morning's worship service. This past Wednesday, some of you are aware, we had FX night here, Family Effects Night. Is that what you call it, Jerry? Family Experience Night. It was a great success. 200 plus people came. Taco bar, games, activities for parents, for kids. It was a great family night. The next one is on December the 21st. So if you want to mark that on your calendar or put that in your phone, December the 21st. Haiti fundraiser. Excuse me, there's some information in your bulletin. Haiti fundraiser, Hoss's Steakhouse, Duncansville, on October the 30th. October the 30th, if you go to Hoss's Steakhouse, we will be giving you in the weeks ahead a little coupon that you can take with you. 25% of your bill goes to fundraising for our teams that are going to Haiti in February. So we'll get you those little coupons here in a couple weeks coming up, but mark it on your calendar, October 30th. Duncansville Hosses. There are some needs for children's workers. Jerry informed us here a couple weeks ago that we have 22 preschoolers in that little room. I think I've got it right, preschoolers in that little room over there. So we're going to have to divide up in order to spread them out. But we need more teachers. We need volunteer help. Please, if you are available, and I know that oftentimes as we get older, we say, well, I did my time with that, so I'm kind of you're the people that we need. We need you there to set an example, to love those kids and show those kids. So if you are able to help, please get in touch with myself or Jerry, and we'll get you involved. Gentlemen, if you would come forward for this morning tithes and offerings. Just a congratulation to Matt and Laura Beal. They were married yesterday. Laura is the daughter of Denny and Lisa Weil, who attend here. And also congratulations to Josiah and Angela York in the birth of a baby boy, Oliver David. So we want to congratulate both of them. Let's pray, please. Father, we come before you this morning, and we pray that we will be able to clear all of the stuff that's in our minds and put that aside, Father. We come here for the intent purpose of one thing, and that is to worship you. So may we put the troubles of the week or the week ahead or whatever may be directing our thoughts and our hearts towards other things other than you, put them aside, Father. We ask that you would help us to devote completely to worshiping you. And one of the ways that we do that is giving back what you have so graciously blessed us with. So receive this offering, Father, for the furtherance of the gospel. We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
When we made that video, Danny and I had to make an agreement. We're not going to sing the song Ever Be for a while because I think it's probably ruined for a little while. But so this morning, Pastor Darrell's sharing with us, and he's going to be talking about fear and where we place that fear. So throughout our worship set here, the next three songs, we're going to focus on the greatness of God because the proper place to place our fears, obviously, in God and in nothing else. So we're going to focus on his greatness. So as we worship through giving our tithes and our offerings this morning, let's focus on that. Let's take a minute or two just to focus on God's greatness, maybe something he's done in your life or maybe just creation, whatever helps you connect with God the best and makes you just appreciate his greatness. So let's take some time to do that, and then we'll stand and we'll sing.
Down.
shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble
who can stop the Lord Almighty?
stop, Lord Almighty? Who can stop the 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 Lord Almighty?
Who stands behind
The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. I know who goes before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Dear Jesus, please allow that truth to be in our hearts, that you are always with us. I pray that as we go through your word this morning, that you would examine our hearts, that you would give us teachable spirits, that we would agree with you when you call us out in our lives, and allow us to listen to your instruction and how we can love you more and be better disciples for you and for the kingdom. In your name, amen. At this time, our children are dismissed for children's church. Not gonna lie, one of the things I enjoy sitting up here, I get to do this. It's fun to me. All right, so to get things started, I want to show you something. If you look up here, we're gonna have a picture that's gonna come up. That is the Huntsman Spider. The reason why it's called the Huntsman Spider is that it could create a web, it could just wait for prey to come to it, but it actively enjoys hunting. It would fit perfectly in the cove. So this is one of the world's largest spiders, and I was looking up some research on the Huntsman Spider, and I was on YouTube, and I was scrolling down through the comments, and one guy said this. He was in Hawaii, and in Hawaii, he went to his garage one night, and the lights are off, and he goes in the garage, and he sees, like, this thing just running, like, on the ground. He thought it was his, like, dog. He thought it was his puppy. He turns on the lights. It's the Huntsman Spider, like, just staring at him. And what does this guy do? He takes, like, lighter fluid, throws it on the spider, and he lights it on fire. He said the spider screamed at him. He said the spider screamed, and it began just running side to side, and then began, like, charging him, like this little fireball, like this demon from hell is, like, running at him. And then he ran out the garage, shut the door, and he was as pale as a ghost. The reason why I'm telling you this story is because a few weeks ago, me and the youth group and some youth leaders, we went to a place called Uprise. And while we were at Uprise, it was like 9 p.m. It was dark. I was talking with three students. And, you know, I'm just like saying, how's life going and everything? How are you doing? Trying to, you know, form relationships, trying to be pastoral in my job. And one of them, she tells me this. Hey, you have a spider crawling on your neck. And I'm laughing, like, okay, that's funny. Yeah, spider crawling on my neck. Well, okay, knock off. And she's like, no, I'm really serious. There's a spider crawling up your neck, and it's glowing. And once I heard that, I thought of Huntsman Spider instantly. And once I realized they weren't kidding, my face did this. And then every ounce of masculinity left my body. And I got up, and I screamed, get off me, get off me, get off me, help me, get off me.
And, you know, there's just like three girls. They're just staring at me. And I'm like, help me. Get it off. And one of them, she stands up. And then she gives like this vicious chomp to my neck. And I like just go down back in my chair. And I think she killed the spider. But I think there was some pent-up anger towards me. I don't know if that blow was as necessary as it was. But I realized that night, I have a lot of fear. And I began thinking about fear a lot. How does fear play out in the lives of Christians? That I think a lot of us, if we're honest, you read this book. You read about Jesus. You read about the disciples. You read about the lives that they lived. Then you look at your life and you realize there's a huge disconnect from what happens in this book and how you live your lives. That many of us, if we're honest, we would say we live insignificant lives for the gospel. That we live really small lives for Jesus. And I think the reason is because of fear. But then once again, how does fear play itself out in the lives of disciples? If you have your Bibles, turn to Matthew chapter 10. And as you're turning there, we're going to be in verse 16. And to give you some context, what's happening here, you have Jesus. He's gathered the 12 disciples, the 12 apostles, and he's saying this: I'm about to send you out on a mission, that he's about to send them out to all of Israel. And he says, I want you to share the gospel with all of Israel, that he tells these 12 men that. So let's pick up in verse 16. And what does he say to them? Behold, I am sending you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be as wise as serpents and as innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you over to the courts and flog you in their synagogues. And you will be dragged before governors and kings for my sake to bear witness before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you over, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say, for you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver brother over to death, and the father his child, and children will rise against parents and have them put to death, and you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But the one who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. If they have called the master of the house Beelzebub, how much more will they malign those of his household? Imagine that. Imagine being there, that Jesus calls you over and he says, hey, that's my mission for you, that what you're going to do has a highly likely chance, there's a good probability you're going to die. That if you don't die, they're going to hate you. That the message I want you to share, it could turn your own children against you. I imagine being one of the disciples, and you hear that, and your eyes start bugging out, right? That your heart starts quickening, that there, you start sweating, that there's a lot of fear right there. And Jesus, knowing the hearts of people, what does he say in the very next verse? Verse 26. So have no fear of them. That Jesus knows people. He knows it's a very scary mission. He knows this will put a lot of fear in your heart. So Jesus says, have no fear of them. Don't fear the mission I've given you in life. And why does he say that? For nothing is covered that will not be revealed, or hidden that will not be known. What I tell you in the dark, say in the light, and what you hear whispered, proclaim on the housetops. And do not fear those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. That Jesus says, don't be scared of the mission I've given you. Don't be scared of the people you're going to share the gospel with. Jesus says, hey, don't be scared of the one that can destroy your body. Be scared of the one that can destroy you in hell. That a lot of us, we read that verse and we feel like that Jesus is saying, hey, you know, don't be scared of people, be scared of the devil. And if you read that verse that way, that's the wrong way to read that verse. That when Jesus says, fear the one that can destroy your body and soul in hell, he's not talking about the devil. He's talking about his father. Let that sink in. That Jesus says, don't fear the mission. Fear God. That's what Jesus would tell us today. That it's not that you don't have any fear, but that you fear God. So the question becomes this. What does fear mean? What does the Bible mean when it says fear? That if you go back to the original language, the whole idea of fear there, it means this, that be in awe of something, to have great respect of something, to literally be afraid of something. So Jesus is saying, hey, have great respect for God. Be in great awe of God. In some sense, be afraid of God. So on one hand, Jesus says, fear God, don't fear people. And then he says this right here, verse 29, are not two sparrows sold for a penny, and not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your father? But even the hairs of your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore you are of more value than many sparrows. On one hand, Jesus says, fear God. On another hand, Jesus says, God welcomes you into his presence. That Jesus talks about sparrows, and sparrows were the cheapest animal you could buy for sacrifices back then. That, you know, two sparrows cost less than a penny, and so no one cared about sparrows. That sparrows were it was an insignificant animal back then. But Jesus says this, whenever a sparrow dies, my father is there. Whenever an insignificant sparrow dies, it dies in the presence of my father. That Jesus would say this. He says, hey, if my father is there when a sparrow dies, will he not be with you when you live your life? If God cares that much about birds, how much more does he care about you? That I remember the story that a friend told me, and he was a missionary. He goes to dangerous countries in the world where the gospel isn't allowed to be preached. And he told me he met this one friend of his, and she was a nurse, and she's in this closed country to the gospel. She has some friends there, and she was terrified every single day of being in that country, that she feared she was going to be killed every single day for the gospel. And anyway, so she's, you know, working in this hospital. She has her friends there. You know, they take in sick people. They're Christians. They share the gospel with people who come there. Well, one day she's out. She's not there. And radical Muslims, they found the hospital, and they slaughtered everyone in there. That it was just chaos what they did to sick people and to her friends. And she heard what happened. She rushed back, and she knew she would have to identify the bodies of her friends. And she said she was filled with great fear, that she didn't want to go into that room, but she knew she had to. And she walked into that blood-soaked room with all these bodies maligned and destroyed. And she said she felt the peace of God there. She said with all the fear she had, she walked into that room, and she said it was the presence of the living God in there. And she said, I'm not scared to go anywhere for Jesus now because I know that he's there. That the Bible teaches us this, that we should fear God, but yet God welcomes us in his very real presence. That, how do we see this play out in Scripture? That the same God who created heaven created hell. Be mindful of that. That the God that created heaven says, hey, you're welcome to my presence. Hey, come have a relationship with me. That same God created hell, so you should really fear him. The same God that created this. The same God that created the lion created the lamb. Something that could kill you, God created. And something so innocent that you wouldn't have any fear of it, God also created. That creation teaches us about God. That the same God that created the lamb created the lion and also the huntsman spider. That thing freaks me out. But anyways, so fear God, and yet you're welcomed in his presence. So how many of you ever read the Chronicles of Narnia? All right. So you know the Chronicles of Narnia, C.S. Lewis, he portrays God as a lion, and he does that on purpose. I remember in the first book, in the first movie, the kids find out that Aslan is a lion, and Lucy is like, well, he's a lion. I thought he was like a person, but he's a lion. Is he safe? Is it okay to be around him? And the beaver said this. Safe? Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe. But he's good. He's the king, I tell you. That, once again, God is not safe, right? That God is the most powerful person in this universe. That God can speak you out of existence if he desired. That God could, whatever man could do to you, God could do much worse. God isn't safe, but he's good. And because he's good, he welcomes you into his presence. And the best picture we see of God's fear and God welcoming of sinners is right here. The cross. The cross reminds us that God hates sin. Let that sink in. God hates sin. The thoughts you had last night that were sinful, God hates. That if God would do that to his own son because of his hatred of sin, and if we are sinners, that should put some legit fear of God in us. But at the same time, it's at the cross where God welcomes sinners into his presence. The whole story of the Bible, fear God, but know that God invites you into his very real presence. And if you would do me a favor, look back at verse 31 in Matthew chapter 10. And look what it says. Fear not, therefore you are of more value than many sparrows. That once you understand the fear of God in your life, it puts genuine peace there. Once you understand the fear of God, it puts genuine peace in your life. So what happens if we don't fear God? Let's go to one more slide. So if you take your Bibles, go to Mark chapter 4. And because I love giving things away before you actually read the text, there's a storm, and there's a boat, and there's Jesus. So kind of giving some things away right there. So if you understand all that, so Jesus, he's on a boat with his disciples, and this massive storm breaks out. And it's like rocking the, okay, rock the boat, rock the big, it's in my head, sorry, I had to get it out there. But anyways, so you have all that stuff going on. So let's jump down to verse 37, and what does it say? Mark 4, verse 37. And a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat, so that the boat was already filling. But Jesus was in the stern, asleep on the cushion, and they woke him, that's the disciples, they woke him and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" That the disciples are in this storm and the boat's overflowing. They're in this circumstance. It's causing great fear. It's causing great panic to the point that they doubt the goodness of Jesus. That they run up to him and they're like this, "Hey, Jesus, do you not care that we are perishing?" How many times have you found yourself in that same position? Right? That maybe you lost a job and you lose a job and great fear rises in your heart. And you say, "Hey, Jesus, do you not care? I can't afford my rent." Right? Maybe it's a situation with your kids, right? And you see your kids, they're slipping away from the gospel and it causes great fear in you as a parent. And you say, "Hey, Jesus, do you not care that my kid's not following you?" Right? Or maybe you're a student and maybe you have parents and you know you're the only one, you're the spiritual leader in your family, and you're like, "Hey, Jesus, don't you care that my mom and dad aren't here?" That all this fear, it wells up inside of you, that circumstances dictate how you feel about Christ, and it makes you doubt his character. So what happens with this? Verse 39. And Jesus awoke, and he rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. Jesus said to them, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" I wonder if 2,000 years later, does Jesus say that to me and you? Why are you so afraid? Why are you so scared? And then Jesus answers it. He answers his own question. "Because you have little faith." You know why you're so terrified about life? You know why you're so scared? It's because you have a little view of me, and you have a really big view of your problems. That's what Jesus boils it down to. And then look what happens in verse 41. And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?" It's not that the fear of the disciples disappeared. Their fear was transferred from their situation over to Jesus. Their fear didn't magically vanish, but their fear was transferred from their situation over to Jesus. That fear is not a bad thing. That if rattlesnakes were to fall from like the ceiling, we would probably like sue the architect or something. But if you run out of here, that's a good idea, right? That fear could save your life at times. It's kind of like this. There's nothing wrong with a desire to eat, but when it becomes gluttony, that's the sin. There's nothing wrong with a desire to sleep, but when it becomes laziness, then it becomes a problem. There's nothing wrong with a desire to have sex, but when it becomes lust, that's when it becomes a problem. There's nothing wrong with fear, but when your fear doesn't find its proper place in God, it becomes anxiety. That Satan twists all these good desires that God gives us, and he twists it into sin, and he twists it into something that works negative in our lives. When it comes to you and fear, when it comes to you as a disciple following Jesus, do you have good fear that leads you to God, or do you have anxiety that leads you nowhere good? Which brings us to Philippians chapter 2. So go to Philippians chapter 2. And look over at verse 12, Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. And this is Paul. He's writing from jail to this church in Philippi. And this is actually the first church that was planted in Europe, is the church in Philippians. So this is the first church planted in Europe in Philippi. And Paul, he's writing to them and from jail. And Paul had kind of been their pastor. He kind of been their father figure. He kind of been their big brother. He was always there helping them out. But Paul in jail, he realizes, hey, I can't be there anymore. So what does Paul tell this church? Paul says this, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling." That Paul says, when he says work out your own salvation, he literally means work out your own spiritual growth. That he says, hey, you know, I can't be there to hold your hand anymore. I can't be there to answer all your questions. Paul says, hey, you have to grow up and work out your own spiritual growth. He says, hey, the mission that God has given you, walk in it. And guess what? He says, walk in it with fear and trembling. Why? Because whatever God has called you to do, it should be bigger than you. Whatever God has called you to do, it should be bigger than you, and it should put some fear in your heart. That, is it not true? We feel most alive when we do things and accomplish things that are outside of our own strength. That the mission that Jesus has called you to do, it should put some awe in you. It should put some fear in you. But what does Paul say in verse 13? Here's why it all works together. Verse 13. For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. That God takes pleasure, not just pleasure, God takes good pleasure in working in your life. And maybe some of you, you have never heard that before, and I want to say that again. God takes pleasure in working with you to help you to accomplish the things he's called you to do. So then when you have that mission, which causes fear and trembling in your heart, take that fear and place it in God, knowing God is bigger than the mission he's called you to do, and God is walking with you every step of the way to accomplish that. So what does that look like in real life? For some of you, this is what you fear. That your finances terrify you, but yet you know God has called you to give. That there's people that want to adopt kids all over this world, that every kid should have a mom and father. And there's tons of orphans in the world. And if you don't adopt an orphan, it means open up your pocketbook and write a check to someone that's trying to adopt. And for some of you, that's the mission God has called you to do. That if you, for some of you, it's going on a mission trip and you're terrified of airplanes, right? But God has called you to that mission. Others of you, if you are in youth, listen to me right now, if you're in youth, some of you, you don't need to spend another summer in Martinsburg. Some of you, you need to go to Operation Barnabas. Others of you, when we go to Urban Hope, you need to go there. And parents, you need to let them go. That there's a psalm, and it says this, that children are arrows in a quiver, and you, it's not that you keep them forever, but that you release them, you release an arrow to the work of God. Others of you, it means this, and I say this from a place of love, and I want to sit down, because I don't want to be a domineering figure when I say this. I want you to know I say this as love, in love as a fellow Christian. How many times have we begged for children's workers? How many times have we asked for someone to step up and be a teacher in children's church? The mission of God for some of you is simply to plug in and serve in his church. That don't let passivity dominate your life. That the mission of God, whatever it is for you, it should put some fear in your heart because it's bigger than you, but at the same time, you know that God is with you. And what about this? What about if you fail? So what if you fail? If you fail, you fail into God. That's the joy of that, that if you fail, you fail into God, and God in his good grace and God in his good love will walk with you and pick you up and help you to accomplish the things he's called you to do, which leads us to our very last verse. Go to Matthew chapter 28. And in verses 18 through 20, it's called the Great Commission. And it's the mission where Jesus says, hey, if you're my disciple, I want you to have an impact in this world. That I want you to go out and live a life that brings others to me. That's the biggest mission any Christian can be called to. And yet that's the mission all of us are called to play out in our lives. But you don't really appreciate verses 18 through 20 unless you understand verses 16 and 17. So what happens in verses 16 and 17? Notice, these are the disciples. They've gone through everything. They've gone through the miracles. They've gone through the crucifixion. They've gone through the resurrection. And yet we come to the end of Matthew, and it ends in the most realistic way possible. Look at verses 16 and 17. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped, but some doubted. That's us, right? That we're tons of worshipers in here. But if we're honest, there's areas of doubt in our heart. There's areas that doubt lives in our hearts. And if I can say honestly, that doubt, there's probably a mixture of fear. So you have these disciples, these 11, they're worshiping Jesus, but yet there's fear also going on. And once again, Jesus, knowing the hearts of people, how does he end Matthew? He says this: all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. All power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey all that I have commanded you. That Jesus is saying, hey, I know you have fear. I know what I called you to do is really big, but guess what? All power, all authority belongs to me. So because that is true, go have an impact in this world. And to really make this really important, look how he ends it. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. That Jesus says this: wherever you go in life, wherever you're living for me, wherever you're accomplishing the mission I've called you to do in your life, all power is given to me, and I am with you every step of the way. The day you have more fear for Jesus than what Jesus has called you to do, you will have more peace in your life, and you will be a more effective disciple for him, and your Christianity will be more real to you. So in saying all that, how about this? We take some time and we pray silently. We talk to Jesus. I'm sure Jesus has been talking to some of you about what you should be doing in your life. So while you're talking to him just silently, we're all going to just do that. And once I start praying out loud, I'll have the band come up and they'll close us out in our last song. So you just take some time and you talk to Jesus right now. Dear Jesus, it's in these awkward moments of silence that decisions are made for eternity. I pray that as we went through your word today, that you encouraged us where we needed encouragement. I pray you convicted us where we needed conviction. I pray that as a body of believers, our fear of what you called us to do would be transferred over to you, that we would have a bigger view of who you are than what you called us to do. Please allow that to be true. Please allow us to live transformed lives. Dear Jesus, we throw ourselves upon your mercy. In your name, amen.
Let's stand together.
One more time. Dear Jesus, as we are about to enter out of these doors and maybe to our Sunday school for our ABFs, I pray that maybe we'd have a good conversation later this afternoon about what we've learned here today. I pray that come Monday morning, we will live more in awe of you than what you called us to accomplish this week. And that we would live great lives for the gospel. That we just wouldn't read about people who had great faith, but that we would experience what they experienced because we live lives like them with a big view of who you are. In your name, amen.